Hey everybody, Bob Babbitt here. We're with Mr. Krisky May, the creator, founder, main man for VeloFix. And VeloFix has been around for how many years now, Chris?
We're 6.5 years now.
Yeah,
co-founder, founded it with two business partners. And some days it feels like 6 minutes, some days it feels like 60 years. But yeah, we're having a lot of fun.
So take me back to when this all started, because didn't you sold another company? And
I'd been involved in some other businesses, and my business partner, David, we had started riding bikes.
Yeah.
And we're very frustrated with the traditional bike shop and how to get your bike fixed. And
because normally I bring my bike in and say, I want you to get a tune-up, and they'd be like, oh, just leave it here for a week.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, to the point of I didn't have a bike rack for my car.
Right.
And now something wrong with the bike, I have to get it to a shop. They can't tell you when it's going to be ready. You don't know which mechanic's working on it. And the whole process just seemed very painful.
Right.
And really, we thought there had to be a better way.
Yes.
So with Uber and Amazon and all these companies generating this awareness that you can get things done at home, you can get things come to you, the concept evolved into, well, can you put a bike shop in the back of a vehicle?
Right.
And then we, Mercedes Sprinter. And can somebody use their phone and book it and we roll up?
And it's really a software play, right?
Yeah, because
you can't have some guy driving all over the city or else it doesn't make financial sense. They've got to be able to coordinate where they're going to be and when they're going to be.
Yeah, route optimization software, which allows us, to your point, of being in certain areas at certain times.
Right.
One of the big challenges in cities, and the reason the bike shops have a challenge, is getting to them.
Right.
The traffic time. So, we're in New York, Philadelphia, Boston, Chicago, LA, San Francisco. So basically the route optimization is it pockets zip codes, and we work in certain zip codes. So the vehicle's not doing what you're talking about, windshield time. So that's a big part of it. The customer service piece, how we treat our customers, the products that we're able to sell out of the van, the level of quality of our technicians, all those things come into play. And we use Net Promoter Score, which is something that we live and die by. And our average Net Promoter Score is over 96%, meaning when somebody gets a service, we ask them 1 to 10, would you recommend us to a friend? And 9.6 people say, yes, I would. And that is an astronomically high score.
Yeah.
But that's something that we focus on from day one, because that's something we thought was missing in the old.
No question.
In the old. So we, the mechanic comes, the interaction's better. It's one-on-one. There's no intimidation. You're in the back of a van. We offer you a coffee.
Right.
And you can ask, hey, what about this? And you don't have that intimidation factor. So launched the business, started franchising it. Have about 150 franchise partners across North America. We are now opening an office in Austin, Texas, and launching our first corporately owned stores in Austin. So we will do a combination of franchises and corporately owned, and just continue to build the fleet.
So in markets where you have franchisees, you're not going to bring in
corporate. No. I mean, we love our franchise partners. They're a huge part of what we do. It would make no sense to go and compete against them or be in the same markets. Really, this just allows us to grow faster and go into specific markets,
right?
If we couldn't find a franchise partner or somebody that wanted to buy a franchise. So
when you first started, I remember being at the bike show in Vegas, and manufacturers wanted nothing to do with you, right? They were upset. They were going to be upset. They're the independent bike dealers, but meanwhile, the IBDs have been going away.
Absolutely, yeah. It's a tough one, and I've been in similar industries where that independent retailer is getting squeezed.
Yes.
So they're getting squeezed by online. They're getting squeezed by big box.
Right.
And then they're getting squeezed by even more boutique-y type of bike shops.
Right.
And it's no different than any other industry. I think the bike industry was a little late to the game because you still need to build the bike. There's a mechanical piece to it.
Right.
So, you and I order a pair of shoes online.
They're there tomorrow.
Yeah. We know how to lace them up and start running. The bike was still one of the problems. So helmets and shoes, clothing, that stuff all went early. The bike piece came later. And ultimately, at the end of the day, part of our business model is last mile white glove delivery service. So Canyon's a great partner of ours in North America. If you buy your Canyon online, we'll bring it to your house. We'll build it for
and
you. Set it up and give you a quick fit and then take the packaging away. And then, by the way, if you have a problem, we'll come back and fix
work
that. And I think that's the evolution of our business, where we have at home. So you book online, we come to your home and office and look after your bikes. We have a delivery piece. We do a lot of corporate work. Apple, Google, Snapchat.
I know.
They've all got fleets of bikes on campuses. They need them serviced. They also want their employees riding to work. And they put incentives in place to say, hey, you need to commute. Places like Tesla in Silicon Valley, you can't park.
No.
There's no
They want you on a bike, and so they'll actually pay for some of your tune-ups
Absolutely.
From you.
Yeah.
for people if they ride their bikes to work.
Which works well for us. And now you've got all these evolutions happen. Electric bikes is massive.
So are you working on electric bikes?
Yeah, we do
now?
A lot of work on electric bikes. One of our partners just landed a big deal with Domino's Pizza. So Domino's Pizza in the U.S. is going to deliver pizzas with electric bikes. And we do all the deliveries and the builds and the ongoing maintenance of those.
So. And so your guys will be delivering pizzas. That's so cool.
You know what? It's something we've thought about. You know, what else can we do out of that
van? How about a bike and a pizza?
Yeah.
And so take me through what's in that van. Because it's the Mercedes Sprinter, right?
Yeah. It's the tallest and longest Sprinter they make. It is a full bike shop. I mean, we have every tool, we have every parts and accessory. The reality is, you know, and I see this as a positive, is we only have about 100 square feet with storage. We can't over inventory.
Right.
We can't carry a bunch of things we're not going to sell. So everything we sell is very highly consumable. And, you know, the one thing about the bike industry that I think is fantastic is the suppliers are very good and we get product within 24 to 48 hours. So, for example, if you went online today and booked for Friday, I'm trying to do what day it is, or, you know, 3 or 4 days out.
Yeah.
And said, I have a problem with my bottom bracket on my Cervelo, we would know what part to bring in and make sure we have.
Right.
So that type of the business is evolving. Our e-com piece, you know, we're starting to build out our e-commerce piece so we could sit in the van and hand you an iPad and you could order a helmet and shoes and it'll get delivered right to your house. So a lot of things we're working on. But yeah, unfortunately, the current retail model in bike is a tough one. There used to be about 7,000 independent bike shops and I think there's 3,800 left. And it's for a lot of reasons, and that's unfortunate. But like a lot of businesses, things evolve, and there's different ways to
get to change.
You have to change. So,
triathlon, the sport of triathlon.
Yeah,
I always call these our guys are the early adopters. Right? Yep. If you go to an expo, if it's a triathlon expo, I always feel that one triathlete equals 5, 6, 7 runners in terms of what they'll buy. Same with the other individual sports, the cycling guys, the swimming guys. Triathletes spend more money. Right, they come into that sport usually having one skill, they're a swimmer or a runner, and then they learn the other two, so they're wide open to whatever equipment.
Absolutely,
right?
Those
were your early adopters.
Yeah, I think I always say that triathletes are our best customers.
Yes,
they have less time than most people. They have less knowledge about their bikes than most people.
None
for a lot of people.
How do I turn on my Garmin?
They have very specific schedules and races.
Yeah,
you know, a lot of road cyclists that we work with don't ever race.
Right.
You know, they're weekend warriors and they ride their bike a lot. But if you're a triathlete, you're typically training for an event.
Right.
You know, you've got something coming up. So that means your bike needs to be dialed for training. You need help packing it when you travel. You need help on the other end when you get there to build it. Tri bikes are more complicated than road bikes, as you know. So yeah, we love the triathletes. And the other beautiful thing of triathletes, to your point about early adopters and sharing that information. You know, I always joke if somebody wins Kona in pink shoes,
Everybody's got pink shoes.
And for us, we've had our franchise partner in Dallas, phenomenal success. He's a triathlete. He focused on that market. And word spreads fast.
Right.
So, yeah, love triathlon. And then personally, I love it as well because, I mean, running is really my thing. I've gotten into riding more. I'm not a great swimmer, but I love having something that I'm not very good at. And the group I'm over with, the boys I'm with, are all phenomenal athletes.
Right.
And I love riding my bike with guys that are way better than me. And love swimming with somebody who's way better than me. So it's been great.
I'm just the opposite. I like going out with people who really suck. I want to be better than everybody. I need to be the fastest guy in the room.
Yep.
So which means I have nobody to go out with because everybody's better.
Room.
It's a very quiet room.
Yeah, I think I may get there too, but I mean that's the thing with triathlon is it's kind of like golf. Like, you never really get it.
No.
You know,
even on
your best day, I'm sure Jan Frodeno on his best day ever is like, you know what? I probably had another couple minutes in me somewhere.
Right.
And those other specific sports, you know, I like the variation of it and, you know, the people you get to meet.
Yeah.
It's a great community.
So you've gone really from zero franchisees to 150 in 6 years.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't franchise right away, but, you know, I'd say the last 5.5 years.
Yeah. Yep. And what do you want to do next?
Yeah, so we're gonna keep putting corporate trucks in the store. We're on the ground. We're gonna keep selling franchises, and the goal is to keep getting our footprint bigger and bigger. We got a lot of requests outside of North America.
Yeah, I was wondering about that. That's a lot of complications.
It is. Right? Yeah, I believe if it works in North America, it can work very well in other places. The UK.
Right.
We get a lot of requests from South America. So yeah, one day we will be international, but today we'll focus on North America.
Love it. As always, appreciate all the support. for all of our breakfast shows and for Challenge Athletes Foundation.
Love it.
And love what you guys are doing.
Awesome. Thanks, Bob. Thanks for the time.
Chrisky May from VeloFix has been our guest. Hold on, everybody. We will be right back.